And as we look at your word tonight, we pray that you would help us to see the things that you would have us to see. In the Savior's name, amen. Well, let's open our Bibles to Judges chapter 15 and look at Samson. And we've been in the book of Judges for 4.5 months, and I must confess that much as I have valued time in this, I'm looking forward to getting out of there. And Samson makes me eager to get beyond as well. It's such a sad story. I mean, these wonderful exploits that you hear about and you thrill at. But when you think of Samson, you can only think of squandered possibilities of someone who had a supernatural birth, who had a supernatural divine calling and a mission, who was going to be used by God to deliver his people, and yet over and over makes the wrong choices. You'll notice that in the outline, I've called it by two names, and I forgot to change it on this, so it's Sunstorm. Sunstroke was the other, and this is a series of bad puns on the name Samson. I think the first one was the rising of the sun or the birth of the sun, and then the dark side of the sun, and then now the sunstroke, and next week will probably be sunset. Samson meaning sun, S-U-N. And part of the story of Samson is given in the fact that even though his parents had that marvelous revelation from the Lord, they still gave him a pagan name related to sun worship rather than a name that in any way bore the name of God and represented praise to God, which is something of the tragedy of the story. Okay, so chapter 13, we have the birth of Samson. Totally different than the birth of the other judges. This one comes before he's born, comes by a supernatural intervention of God in a miraculous way. Others have come by the Lord appearing, for example, to Gideon. Well, he's the epitome of weakness and the Lord coming alongside. But this one comes to a couple, not an enormously godly couple, although the wife, the husband seems to be a loser named Manoah, and the wife seems to have some spiritual sensitivity and insight. And Samson is born, and he's going to begin to deliver his people Israel. This is the first time. All of the other judges have delivered Israel, even though briefly, from a foreign oppressor. The oppressor is the Philistines. They are in power, and we'll see it talked about clearly today. But their methodology is not so much oppression, although it's there, but it's assimilation and drawing them in. And look for two things as we go through this passage. One is Samson, and the other is the position of especially the tribe of Judah that was called by God to be the tribe from which its leader is going to come. But they are a totally defeated people and acquiesce to the Philistines, as we'll see that. So, chapter 14, and all of these events in chapter 14 are built around Samson being attracted to the wrong women and moving in the wrong direction. And all of these come out of chapter 14 and 15 out of his seeing a Philistine woman in the town of Timnah, about 6 miles away from Zorah, his hometown, and saying to his parents, "Get her for me." They agree after having been distressed by him asking that. They arrange the marriage. Samson and this kind of curious interlude with a lion attacking him when he's off by his own with his parents, him killing with his bare hands the lion, and then not telling anybody about it, which seems very strange. And it seems to have been in a vineyard. Now, he's under a Nazarite vow. And in the Nazarite vow, he is to avoid contact with death. He's to avoid contact with anything related to eating grapes or drinking wine or any other thing related to the fruit of the vine, and not to have his hair cut. And all of the days of his life, he lives under that particular vow. But there he is, and he comes back later to discover in some amazing way, bees have made a hive in the desiccated corpse of the lion. It hadn't rotted. It isn't flies. It is bees, of all things, who built a honeycomb, and he scoops out some and then gives it to his parents in the contact, making contamination with death by having anything to do with the corpse and contaminating his parents in terms of the cleanliness rituals, and then goes to the bachelor party of his wedding in Timnah, and in that context, he holds a drinking party, 7-day drinking party for the boys ahead of time. Again, not supposed to have anything to do with wine, but this is a place where the wine is flowing pretty freely. And in the context, poses a riddle to his companions. Now, again, this is another thing about Samson. Samson's call was to begin to deliver Israel, but we've mentioned he never once in his life is joined by a single other Israelite in anything he does. He is the Lone Ranger who does what he does on his own, and he doesn't rally the nation. He doesn't bring anybody alongside him. He goes down to Timnah to marry a Philistine. His command is to begin to deliver from the Philistine. He's marrying a Philistine, and the Philistines have to give him a bachelor group, 30 guys, to go to the party. He proposes the drunken riddle about what is sweet and all of that. The wager is 30 suits of clothing, either all by him or one each from all of the 30 people. They betray his wife, or at least bludgeon his wife, blackmail his wife into finding the secret and telling them. She tells them Samson you cheated, so angry that he goes down to Ashkelon, 23 miles away, kills 30 men, takes their clothes, and comes back with their clothes. Nothing very edifying in that story about this is the man who's going to be delivering Israel. And so far his contribution is 30 dead Philistines in a kind of murderous attack. And yet strangely, in the middle of that we read, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon him to help him with the lion, to help him with this episode down in Ashkelon. And then he's angry and he stomps out of there and he heads back to his town in Zorah and abandons his bride at the altar. So that brings us to verses 1 to 3 of chapter 15. After some days, at the time of wheat harvest, Samson went to visit his wife with a young goat. And he said, I will go into my wife in the chamber. But his father wouldn't allow him to go in, or her father wouldn't allow him to go in. And her father said, I really thought you utterly hated her. So I gave her to your companion. Isn't her younger sister more beautiful than she? Take her instead. And Samson said to them, this time I will be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. Pretty straightforward, but let me just obviously notice some things here. The fact that it's wheat harvest is going to anticipate something that is about to happen in the story. So that's background information. Samson heads back as if nothing has happened, carrying a dozen roses under his arm. Only the dozen roses turn out to be a young goat in this particular case. Nothing reaches a woman's heart like a young goat. And so here he is back with the present, and he just assumes, I'm going to go into her and I'm going to consummate the marriage. Now, we're not entirely sure. There's two possibilities. One was that he was married during that 7-day drinking party. Most think the party was going to proceed and then the consummation of the marriage would come at the end. So if he was already married, he says he's going to his wife, and that's the language that's used, and it will be used son-in-law. So either that is the language of what he was convinced, because you could be called someone's wife even before you were married if you were betrothed. We know that from the story of Joseph and Mary in the New Testament. Or when she was left at the altar, as it were, the marriage was considered as annulled. But Samson's oblivious to all of that. he is very strong and he seems to be very dumb, especially when women are involved. And so he heads back and he's got his hand on the door, heading up to her room, and her father said, "You can't go. I was sure that you had hated her." And in this language, that could mean, "I thought you'd divorced her," or "I thought you'd abhorred her. I mean, you'd stomped out of here." And how much they knew at this point, I don't know. Did they know that he'd killed 30 people down in Ashkelon to get the clothes? They clearly fear him and are afraid of him. So probably something has drifted back. So I gave her to one of your best men to avoid the shame, to avoid losing face, to cause her not to be utterly disgraced. He's married her off to another woman. And then he says, "But you should see her younger sister. She really looks good. I'll give her to you." And one of the things you have to recognize in this story is that women are just chattel. They have a power, but it's not the power of people. It's the power of attraction, sexual attraction. But they're just, fathers give away, "Well, okay, I was going to marry you to an Israelite, but he won't go through with it. So here, have this guy. And now I'll give her the younger sister." And Samson isn't interested, which must be the only time he turned out an opportunity to be with a Philistine woman, because there's no evidence of it later in his life. And he says, and notice the language that he uses that is kind of intriguing, "This time I will be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm." Do you find that language intriguing? "This time I'll be innocent" seems to say, yeah, maybe last time when I went and murdered 30 of them who hadn't done me any direct wrong was not exactly a righteous thing to do. But this time, whatever I do is right. And it says, so, verse 4, his foxy revenge, as I put it. And you'll notice this as an issue too. Samson is always not the initiator, but the revenge getter. So the Philistines made him betray his, or pardon me, the Philistines made his wife learn his secret and betray. So in revenge, he goes and kills 30 more. He comes back and says, she'd be given to another man. He's going to take revenge. And over in this story, he's a man who's taking revenge because his honor and his sense of what is right trumps everything else. So Samson said to him, so Samson went and caught 300 foxes. Now, the interesting thing about this is there's nothing said about any supernatural power. And he does this all by himself, apparently. And you try to think, how does that work? What are the logistics of this? Now, most think that, I shouldn't say most, a number think it's the word translated foxes can also be translated jackals. And since foxes are solitary animals and jackals run in packs, there's a possibility and maybe a probability that these are referring to jackals, because getting 300 foxes would take a very, very long time. Getting 300 jackals would still take a lot of time, but okay, you catch them. How do you keep them alive? How do you pin them in? How do you do all of these things? And then tying all their tails together, and then finding some way to put some way of lighting the tail or some thing in the thing on. I mean, this is a lot of work. And it's a remarkable exploit that he's doing all by himself. But the statement simply is that he took 300 foxes and took torches, tied them tail to tail, put a torch between each pair of tails. And when he set fire to the torches, he let the foxes go out into the standing grain of the Philistines. Now remember what time of year it is. It's wheat harvest. We lived on the Canadian prairies for a number of years, and wheat harvest is really an important time. And farmers just, at that time, what they pray for, and this is talking about Canada, obviously, but what they just pray for is that there won't be any hailstorm, or there won't be any heavy rain, or something like that, which will devastate the crop. And to have fire going through your harvest at this particular time is devastating. And this is the plain country, so growing your sources of income. But it isn't just that that happens. The foxes go through the standing grains of the Philistines and set fire to the stacked grain and the standing grain, as well as the olive orchards. So you have, if it was devastating that the wheat was destroyed, wheat's an annual crop. Olive trees that are getting destroyed is extremely significant. So the most important of their economics, this was a huge economic blow at that particular time, and he has struck a big blow, not against just Timnah. And it's interesting, isn't it? When he hears this from his father-in-law, he doesn't retaliate against his father-in-law. He retaliates against the Philistines because he's known that they were the ones who inspired her to betray and so forth. And she betrayed because they had threatened they'd burn down the house with she and her father in it. So that's why she'd betrayed. But verse 6, the Philistines said, "Who's done this?" And they said, "Samson, the son-in-law of the Timnite." So he's still viewed in some way as legally in that mix because he's taken his wife and given it to her companion. And the Philistines came and burned her and her father with fire. So they take their revenge, but not on Samson, intriguingly. And then Samson, it says in verse 7, he said to them, and I don't know who the them is there, but some Philistines apparently, "If this is what you do, I swear I will be avenged on you. And after that, I will quit." And you know, that's the problem with revenge. Even though he says he'll quit, he doesn't quit. Because you can't quit. It's sort of like the Hatfields and the McCoys. That you've done me, I owe you one. Now, you've done me, so I owe it to you, and it goes on, and that's what it is, back and forth, this whole outworking of revenge. And we're not told what specifically he did. All it says is, and he struck them hip and thigh with a great blow. And nobody knows what exactly that means. It looks at some kind of slaughter, and some have thought, well, that just means the body parts were left lying around. Maybe, but it's some massive act of violence on his part by himself, and he went down and stayed in the cleft of the rock of Etam. So what he does after this is goes and finds a cave in the area of Judah. He goes out of the area of Dan, he goes out of the area of the Philistines, and he goes into the countryside of Judah. But all of this is played out on a purely, there's nothing of a desire for anything other than his revenge and his desire. And he's acting utterly on his own. So let's just pause there. I'm not sure that just all we've done is really look at the story, but there's any things that we specifically need. Yes, Mr. Question.
How did the Philistines find out he burnt down the crops in the first place? I mean, we never find out how they found out. I mean, it just, how'd they find out in the first place?
How do you get 150 pairs of jackals or foxes out there without anybody seeing you? I think, and especially when there's a big torch between their tails, somebody's going to notice, and they saw that it was Samson. So I don't know, Connor, how it's worked out, but this couldn't have been a secret.
That damage from the hip and thigh, it might have been burning down one of the towns of the Philistines. Who knows?
It might have been what?
You know, like, he might have burned down Timnah. Who knows?
It says he smote them, so he didn't burn them. It was some kind of physical action he took against them that left a bunch of them killed at that stage. All right. So now, it's my turn if I'm a Philistine. You got me, I'm going to get you. And so we come to verse 9. Then the Philistines came up and encamped in Judah. Now, we're not told very much there. Just they now invade enemy territory. This is Judah's territory. They cross the boundary. This is now an international incident. And we don't know how many came, but we do know two things. We know that before this battle is over, 1,000 of them will be dead. So there's at least 1,000 Philistines involved in this. And I think reason suggests that he didn't kill all of them. He killed a good number of them, and a number could get away. So we're talking about thousands of Philistines cross the border at this particular time. And they demand Samson. They made a raid on Lehi. Now, this is used in an anticipatory way, just to go on. Lehi, L-E-H-I, means jawbone. It wasn't called jawbone before the story. It's going to be called jawbone afterwards, but he's just using the term that is going to become relevant as it goes on. So they make some kind of raid. And the men of Judah said, "What have you come up against us? What's going on?" And they respond, "We've come to bind Samson to do to him as he did to us." So, I don't know whether the story had gotten to the people of Judah. Obviously, it had, from what happens next, that he had committed great acts of violence against the Philistines. And they come and they say, "We want him. Surrender Samson to us for our revenge." So they made it very clear. The end is they are going to minimally torture him and almost certainly execute him. They're after that. So here's the part where you begin to say, you know, Samson was a failure, and he was. He squandered his gifts, he squandered his opportunities, but look what he had to deal with. So, 3,000 men of Judah went down to the cleft of the rock of Etam. So the Judahites are able to get 3,000 men together to do battle against one man, Samson. The intriguing thing is they go to Samson with the sole purpose of getting him to surrender. And there's nothing here of even beginning to think, maybe we should join Samson. Maybe we should fight the Philistines. They are utterly defeated. And that becomes really evident in what they go to Samson and what they end up saying to him. Don't you know that the Philistines are rulers over us? What then is this that you've done to us? In other words, you've upset the status quo. They're our rulers. They are more concerned to care for the Philistines than they are to care for Samson. They are thoroughly defeated, and they have no vision of what God wants them as a nation to be. The book of Judges, if we had time and we went back, well, we should go back. Turn back to chapter 1 just for a minute. verse 1 of chapter 1 of Judges. After the death of Joshua, the people inquired of Yahweh, who shall go up first for us against the Canaanites to fight against them? Yahweh said, Judah shall go up. I've given the land into his hand. And Judah said to his brother, Simeon his brother, come up with me into the territory allotted to him so we may fight against the Canaanites. And I likewise will go with you in your territory allotted to you. So Simeon went with him. Judah went up, and the Lord gave the Canaanites and the Perizzites into their hand, and they defeated 10,000 of them at Bezek. And it goes on talking about all the victories that Judah had begun with. And now, don't you know the Philistines are rulers over us? What have you done to us by bringing Philistines into our territory? And the thing that's striking to me is that Samson, for whatever reason, when they say, we've come down to bind you that we may give you into the hand of the Philistines. So we're going to turn you over. That's what we're here for. And they're afraid of him enough. I mean, 3,000 after one, that's a fairly strong set of odds. They're expecting to have to fight him. And they're willing to put their life on the line to fight Samson, but not to fight the Philistines. And Samson simply says back to them, swear to me that you won't attack me yourselves. And they respond, no, we'll only bind you and give them into your hands. We surely won't kill you. And Samson, this on one level seems out of character, but he won't kill a fellow Israelite. He won't fight them. And I don't know whether behind this, well, one of it is it would be, you need to understand here that this is in some way an honor-shame culture. And it would be a shame to be killed by your own people. To be killed by the enemy, there's some honor in that. But to be killed by your own people is a disgrace. So he doesn't want to be killed by his own people. But he doesn't also the same to them, listen, join with me and we can go to war. He submits. He allows them to bind him. And then they begin to march him toward the Philistines. Now, I don't know, and this is a question you can ponder, and maybe you have the answer to this. Did Samson expect what happens? Did he really just submit, or did he really believe that somehow God was going to enable him and empower him, even as he submits to being bound by his own people? I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting question. In other words, is this an act that has some faith in it, some trust in God? It's possible. So, just to follow the rest of the story, when he came to Lehi, this particular area, the Philistines come shouting to meet him. So they see him being bound. The Judeans are pushing him forward in front of them. And all of a sudden, the Philistines come like, you know, rushing across the way to grab hold of Samson. So there's this rush of this huge army toward Samson at this particular point. And suddenly, God's empowerment comes on Samuel. The Spirit of Yahweh rushed on him, and the ropes that were on his arms became as flax that has caught fire, and his bonds melted off his hands. So all of a sudden, he was utterly free. And he apparently sees at this point the fresh jawbone of a donkey. That's important because this was not old and brittle. It was a fresh jawbone, so it would still have strength and it would still have the teeth in it. And he put out his hand and took it, and with it he struck 1,000 men. I can't even picture that. I don't know. But remember back in chapter 3, verse 31, we had Shamgar, who killed 600 Philistines with an ox goad. So now we've got him with a jawbone, a fresh jawbone. And that is an interesting thing. A fresh jawbone would come from where? A corpse. So he gets the weapon and uses it, and once again, another part of his vow is violated in the process, and he still wins the victory in the sight of that. And if 1,000 were killed, as I suggested before, how many panicked and ran at this time? One other thing you'll notice that isn't said, here's one of those things that isn't said. 3,000 Jews are back there watching. And the Philistines begin to go down like 10 pins. And they begin to run away. How many Jews joined in to say, here's our chance, guys, let's go and get them? None. They watched while Samson took on the 1,000 and did nothing. That's interesting, isn't it? Because that's one of those things that isn't said until you step back and think. What was going on? They are so utterly defeated, and they've lost so much of a sense of who they are and what God intends them to be. And then Samson, he loves riddles, he loves playing with words, and so he plays on words, and there's some things in the Hebrew text, the word for jawbone and the word for heaps is very similar. So with the jawbone of a donkey, heaps upon heaps, with the jawbone of a donkey have I struck down 1,000 men. As soon as he'd finished speaking, he threw away the jawbone out of his hand, and that place was called Jawbone Hill, Ramoth Lehi, Ramoth, the high place, the hill. So Jawbone Hill at that particular stage. And then we get the after story. And he was very thirsty. And he called upon Yahweh. This is the first time he's ever said to call upon Yahweh. And it begins well, and then you begin to notice it ends somewhat differently. You've granted this great salvation by the hand of your servant. You gave me this great victory. He credits the Lord with the victory he had. And now, shall I die of thirst and fall into the hands of the uncircumcised? And it's almost he's saying, you gave me this victory, and look at me, you're letting me die of thirst. And if you don't do something, I'm going to... And he's complaining. At the same time, he's thanking God for his victory. He's complaining that he's thirsty afterwards. And he's exaggerating his problem. I'm going to die of thirst. Well, that was extremely unlikely at that stage. But he's utterly focused on himself. So he acknowledges God, but at the same time, he manages to put the attention entirely on himself in the middle of it. And then we have God's response to his complaint. Sharon Carey has this mantra. We do this little thing all the time. It used to happen at Sunday morning at church all the time. How are you this morning, Sharon? Better than I deserve. Every time. Tonight came in. How are you, Sharon? Better than I deserve. And I've often thought that's a really good answer for anybody, because if it goes on the basis of our merit, so it's true for all of us. We're always doing better than we deserve. And Samson gets better than he deserves from the Lord. Because what he deserved from the Lord was not what he got. Having complained in the midst of this victory that he'd entered into solely out of revenge and retaliation, with no sense of God's honor, with no concern for his nation, just to get revenge and to get back as good as he was gotten, God split open the hollow place that is at Lehi, and water came out from it. So miraculously, all of a sudden, water appears. Now, who does that remind you of? People complaining that they're thirsty and having a miracle from the Lord. Yeah, the children of Israel in the desert at Massa and at Meribah, and then again in the book of Numbers, murmuring against the Lord, and the Lord, well, in Exodus makes it clear he's pretty ticked off about the way they're behaving, but he still gives them fresh water. And that's what he does with Samson here. His grace provides for his need, and when he drank, his spirit returned and he revived. The name of it, therefore, the name of it was called the place of the caller. C-A-L-L-E-R, place of the caller, the one who called. Well, that's intriguing as you think about it. What he celebrates by giving it that name is not that God had given him water, but that he'd called upon the Lord. And so once again, it's Samson. He is a first-class narcissist who everything is determined by that first statement, she looks good to me, get her for me. And now it's, I need water, get me water. And then it says, and he judged Israel in the days of the Philistines, 20 years. And I think in your notes, I put some comment like, 20 years of what? Because there's no deliverance from the Philistines. There's no turning of the nation to God. In all of the other places, they had rest. They didn't have rest under Samson. The Philistines were still there. They didn't have a renewal spiritually. He led them for 20 years. And that's going to be repeated again at the end of this next chapter. Now, in all of this, what do we make of it? In some ways, this Samson is the epitome of the nation of Israel. That they are a people who were born in a remarkable way, miraculously. First of all, by Isaac being born as the seed, way the promise, way back to Abraham, and then the Exodus. They are a nation whose birth is a miracle. And they are people who have a unique calling. They were set apart, like Samson was, from all the people of his generation. They're set apart from all the nations of the earth. And they're given a mission to be a kingdom of priests in the world. And they keep falling in love with pagan women. In this, in the Israeli sense of foreign gods. And the Bible uses that language of going after spiritual immorality, spiritual adultery in those particular ways. And that's Samson, constantly fraternizing with the enemy, constantly failing to live up with his right. And yet in the midst of it all, God still remains gracious. And when they get in times of desperation, he still comes and responds. And the amazing part of this story in one way is not just Samson, but it's the tribe of Judah, which has declined so deeply, but that's going to be the tribe from which Messiah comes. And that's going to be the source out of which God is going to bring blessing, the lion of the tribe of Judah. And so out of this pathetic disobedience, God is still at work. And as I was thinking about this, even as we were getting up this morning, before I was getting up here tonight, I was thinking, I wonder if we saw how the church looks from God's view, whether we'd look a lot more like Samson than we'd like to think we do. You know, having these wonderful privileges from God and yet constantly, rather than being what God's called us to be, playing with the Canaanites and the Philistines and getting seduced into secondary things. And yet God remains gracious to us. So, as Sharon reminds me whenever I meet her, we're always getting better than we deserve out of his grace and out of his blessing. It is all about his goodness to us. Okay, well, I'd love to tell you that next week doesn't get more depressing, but it doesn't get more depressing because this is about as low as you can go, but it doesn't get much higher as we go through there. Any things that you want to observe about Samson or about some of the things we've looked at or talked about today?
Just a question.
You're not allowed to ask me questions unless you have the microphone. I think we're going to try that at home.
Okay. I just wanted to know at what point would Samson have shown his faith? The place you every time he uses his own power or the power of the Spirit coming on him, is that an act of faith? I mean, he's going to do that next week in the finale.
I mean, clearly there's an act of faith when he ultimately prays for the Lord, you know, help me, and he uses the name of God in its fullest at the end of chapter 16.
Okay, so that would be why he ends up in Hebrews 11. Because otherwise, it doesn't seem like he fits.
That seems to be the major
evidence
of faith in his life. So.
So it says that he judged Israel for 20 years. And the way that I've understood being a judge in Judges is to be kind of like a tribal leader or warrior to go to battle. But the stories that we've heard about Samson, he's kind of acted on his own for his own ego. So does that imply that then the Philistines, after this happened, kind of followed him and they were at war?
We don't read of anything. I mean, the only thing we read, well, there's one other incident at the beginning of chapter 16. We're not quite sure. And then you go to the end of his life. So these events must have been when he was around 20 years of age. And he dies, you know, somewhere around 40. I don't know. I don't know anything about... we're not told of any battles. We're not told of anything he did. Every other judge, you're exactly right. So I think the fact that there's a gap there, it says he judged Israel for 20 years, but then there's a big gap and we're not told anything about it. Sometimes in the Bible, the gaps are eloquent, that he's a judge unlike the other judges. And this is what the judges have descended to. A judge who's a lone ranger, a kind of freak of nature by God's power, who does great exploits that ultimately make virtually no difference in the life of the nation. So there's no indication he has any major spiritual influence on his own people at all. So all I can think of is that he's a judge unlike what a judge is meant to be. So. Okay, well, we're going to press on. We've got probably three more times in the book of Judges. Then I think to try to balance this, we're going to go into the book of Ruth, which is set in the same period, but puts us into a very different kind of framework. And the book of Ruth is a wonderful story. It's one of the great stories in the Bible, but what it reveals of God is profoundly significant. So that's where we're kind of headed here at this stage. All right, well, I wouldn't want to keep you from the dust storm if it arrives at 8 o'clock. So. And there is the three-year word search cake. So let's give thanks to the Lord. Father, we thank you that you've allowed us to have this privilege of meeting together over these years. And we thank you for your word. It reaches us at lots of different places. Sometimes even like these stories make us wonder, why did you need to tell us these things? But it reminds us that apart from your great grace in our lives, nothing ultimately good will come. And it reminds us not to live for ourselves and not to live just to fulfill our desires. But to live for something greater, and that is the glory of you, our great God, and your Son, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.